All right, good morning, everyone, and welcome to First Church of the Nazarene. We're so glad that you're here to worship with us this morning. Let's stand as we begin with our music with Holy is the Lord.
Glad that you're here this morning and excited to be able to worship together and no snow this morning. Wasn't that nice? And some of our friends got some snow, so we're glad that we didn't. Let's begin with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your love for us and for the privilege of being able to gather together today in this place. Father, as we come together, as we gather in, I know that we come with burdens and concerns, things that are weighing heavily upon us. And so today I just pray that you would guide our time, that you would help us to hand those burdens over to you and to see what you can do in the dead areas of our life. Father, we thank you for the life that you bring us. And we pray that today we will feel that we have been in your presence and that you have met with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And you may be seated. Well, a couple of announcements as we get started this morning. First of all, PM service tonight at 6 p.m. And we'll be taking a look at 1 Corinthians. We finish Ezekiel today, just so you know. And we'll be starting 1 Corinthians tomorrow. It's no April Fool's joke. We're starting 1 Corinthians. Our next food pantry, wow, my grammar this week, starting off that way, is April 11th. And if you want to help with that, you can sign up in the foyer. We've had a great time, this new ministry of serving the West End. And if you would like to help with that, we need a lot of volunteers. Last month we served 167 families, I believe. And that number keeps growing, so it'll be on the Thursday the 11th. We'd love to have your help. All right, Easter Sunday is coming up on the 21st, and your full schedule is in the bulletin for that. We do need Easter candy, and we need it to be pre-wrapped and brought into the office between now and I think there's a date in the bulletin. I think it's the Sunday before. And we'll have that for our Easter egg hunt that we'll do with the kids that morning. If you would like to order an Easter lily, the order forms are in the bulletin, or there's some out on the Welcome Center. They're $8 a piece. And if you would like to submit a form and a check by April 14th, they'll decorate the service on Easter Sunday, and then after service is over, you can take those home with you, and they can decorate your table as well. Well, the background video this morning is, this is the North Fork of the South Platte River from Pine, Colorado. Did you get all that? North Fork, South Platte, Pine. Okay. Our reading this week, we read about a river, a beautiful river. And I want us to read that passage of Ezekiel as we get started, because I want that to kind of inform our worship today. Ezekiel says, "In my vision, the man brought me back to the entrance of the temple. And there I saw a stream flowing east from beneath the door of the temple and passing to the right of the altar on its south side. The man brought me outside the wall through the north gateway and led me around to the eastern entrance. There I could see the water flowing out through the south side of the east gateway. Measuring as he went, he took me along the stream for 1,750 feet and led me across. The water was up to my ankles. He measured off another 1,750 feet and led me across again. This time the water was up to my knees, and after another 1,750 feet, it was up to my waist." I pushed the wrong button with my thumb. Anyway, that's just like the South Fork, North Fork, South Platte River. Really unnecessary, but here's what I want you to catch. He asked me, he said, "Have you been watching, son of man?" Then he led me back along the riverbank. And when I returned, I was surprised by the sight of many trees growing on both sides of the river. Then he said to me, "This river flows east through the desert into the valley of the Dead Sea. The waters of this stream will make the salty waters of the Dead Sea fresh and pure. There will be swarms of living things wherever the waters of this river flows. Fish will abound in the Dead Sea, for its waters will become fresh, and life will flourish wherever this water flows." Life will flourish wherever this water flows. There's a number of ways to apply this. We're going to apply this one way when we look at our sermon this morning. But as we worship, I want us to think about this phrase. Life grows wherever this water flows. As we come into this place this morning, I know that the world is a crazy place. I know that we're living in a crazy time. I know that we have weeks where we're just feeling empty and frustrated. But my prayer is that as we come into this place, as we spend some time looking to the Lord, that this river will touch us, and that we'll receive the life from our worship, from our time together this morning, that we need to go back into the world tomorrow. So let's continue to worship. And as this river flows behind you in the worship, my prayer is that we'll be reminded of that life-giving river that's flowing. Let's stand together. Thank you. As we come into this place, I know we come carrying our burdens and the realities of this life. And I know that for a lot of people, there's some really tough stuff that we're facing. But we have the great privilege as we come together to be able to come before God and to bring our requests and our concerns to Him, knowing that He hears us, knowing that no matter what we're going through, that He's aware of who we are and He wants to. We're going to sing through this chorus again, and I'll ask that you prepare your hearts for prayer. If you want to be seated, if you want to remain standing, if you want to come forward, our altars are open. If you want special prayer, Pastor Larry and Myra will be available in the corner. I just encourage you to take advantage of this opportunity to cry out to God with whatever's on your heart, with whatever you're facing. Father, we thank You so much for Your love for us and for the privilege that we have of being able to gather in this place today. Jesus, I thank you for the ways that you work in our hearts and in our lives, for the ways that you move, the ways that you challenge us, the ways that you encourage us, the ways that you draw us closer to yourself. And God, today, as we gather in this place, I know that we come in from a variety of weeks, from a variety of backgrounds, from a variety of challenges that we're facing. And I pray that you would help each one of us to face, with your help, the lives that you've given us. God, I know that there's a lot of tough stuff. A lot of people who are facing physical challenges. A lot of people who are waiting results of tests. There's a lot of people in our church who are trying to process the results of tests, trying to deal with challenges on the job, challenges with family members, some relational, some health related. Just a lot of stuff that we're processing. And God, we are reminded that even though we think we are self-sustaining, we're reminded how much we need you. And so we take a moment just to lift before you in a time of silent prayer the concerns that are weighing heavily upon our hearts. Father, we thank you that you hear us when we pray. We thank you for the ways that you're moving, the ways that you're changing things in our lives and helping us to see you and to experience you in new and different ways. Father, we pray this morning for those who are struggling in their physical conditions. We thank you for works that you're doing, but yet we also recognize that there's a lot more people who are struggling. We pray for those who are facing the real challenges in relationships. We pray for those who are facing the financial struggles, job struggles. We thank you that you hear all of our prayers. And God, this morning we pray especially for Jackie Adkins as she's getting adjusted to the next 3 months where she'll spend time in the Philippines. And just pray that you would keep her safe and that you would be with her during this time. Father, we pray for many others who are traveling and unable to be here this morning as well. But God, in the midst of all that we're facing, we want to know you better. We want to know you and your presence in our lives. We want your life to flow through us, to impact the world around us. Father, at times we may not know what to say. We may not know how to use the right words. But we find great strength and we're challenged by the prayer that your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And you may be seated. Thank you.
Christ
ushers will come forward at this time, we'll continue to worship through the giving of our tithes and offerings. Jack, would you pray for our offering this morning?
Heavenly Father, it's just good to be in your house, and your grace and mercies are fresh every day, Lord. You're a good giver, and help us to be the givers we need to be. Amen. Amen.
For those of you that have been journeying with us over the last several months, we're at the end of Ezekiel. I was expecting to hear some amens there, some applause or something. We've been, for the last quarter, since January, looking through the book of Ezekiel. And our church's method of studying God's Word is that we take a quarter in the Old Testament, a quarter in the New Testament, and we just try to understand the whole of Scripture and not just those passages that are comfortable. Ezekiel has definitely been one of those uncomfortable journeys, but I'm glad to say that this is the last sermon out of Ezekiel. We wrap up this difficult book, and starting tomorrow, we'll read some of Paul's letters, starting with 1 Corinthians, and then we'll go, I think, through Philemon before we get to the end of June. But the message that we're looking at today is this last part of the book of Ezekiel, is a message that Ezekiel was given at the end of his ministry, and a message that came to Ezekiel at a very sacred time. And so the New Living Translation says April 28th, the Hebrew states at the beginning of the year, 10th day of the month of the ancient Hebrew calendar. Basically, they're saying this is at Passover. This message comes to Ezekiel at the time of Passover, and he's given this vision. Now, he knows, he's heard, that the temple of God in Jerusalem has been destroyed. And all of Jerusalem has been destroyed. There's a few people left, but they're really the kind of people that would hide in the caves. And they're not the kind of people that you would build a society on. We'll just put it that way. God took a hold of Ezekiel in this vision and took him back home to Israel. And when he came in this vision, he saw a city. Now, he knew that Jerusalem had been destroyed, but in this vision, he saw a city. And in this city, there was a temple. And Ezekiel watched as a man measured the temple. And he wasn't told to build this temple when he returned to Jerusalem. He was just told to observe. And that's what Ezekiel did. He observed as this man went through intricate detail. In the last 3 weeks, we've been reading about how tall this door was and how many gates there were and how tall this wall was and how big this room was. And we've been kind of bored with it, to be honest with you. It's that skim reading. I tell my students there's some of the reading that you need to read, and there's some of the reading that you just need to skim read. And this is that skim reading. Yet, in this final vision, there's some powerful messages. And I think part of the message comes from the reality that there's no record that anyone built this temple that Ezekiel is describing. So if it wasn't built, why is it given so much attention? I mean, we've been reading about this for 3 weeks. Why? If this temple was never built. There are a lot of theories to this. One of the theories is that it's representative of the new temple and the new Jerusalem. So in heaven, when all is made right, that this is what the temple is going to look like. There's also a theory that says that the Jews were supposed to build this temple when they returned, but they didn't. Go figure, the Jews not doing what they were supposed to do. There's also a theory that says it's just a symbolic of the sacredness of the God space that the people of Israel needed to be reminded of. Now remember that Ezekiel, as he is hearing this message, as he's seeing this vision, he's actually not anywhere near Jerusalem. He's thousands of miles away in Babylon, where all of the Jews that are viewed as being people that they could build a society on, meaning the best and the brightest, are hauled from Jerusalem to Babylon, and they're told to settle there. The Babylonian government's anticipation was that they would just blend in, and their best minds would blend with the best minds of the Babylonians, and they would have a better society. But the Jewish people had to learn what it meant for them to maintain their identity as God's people, even when they were in a world that wasn't God's world. And I say that not in that God didn't control Babylon or have sovereignty in Babylon, but in the sense that nobody there reflected God. The Babylonians were a very pagan society. They were very much into do whatever feels good, just make sure that you pray to the king of Babylon. And the Israelites needed to be reminded of the sacredness of the God space, even though they weren't anywhere near the God space. So, which one of these theories is correct? Quite honestly, I don't know. And I don't think it really matters. I think there's probably more than one of them that's correct. Perhaps all three of them are correct. We've been looking at the third option, that the need to be reminded of the God space. And I think that, again, you could choose any of these other options and you probably could make a really strong case. But what I want us to think about is, what does the God space look like in the Quad Cities? What does the God space look like for us in our lives in this world? We've been talking about the church specifically for the last couple of weeks. The first week that we talked about this, 3 weeks ago, we talked about the need for the God space, the need to be discipled by God and not the media. If you remember, we talked about the average church attendance right now is once every month. That's average across America. And we also talked about the fact that the average American consumes 11 hours of media a day. And I argued with that thought. It's like, well, I'm not one of those, until I started paying attention. And this little thing, whenever I get in the car, I'm turning something on, whether it's a podcast or whether it's music, because I don't like to listen to other people talk on the radio. I just want to hear music. Or have something going in the background. Of course, it's been March Madness, so I've had a lot of things going in the background. But the reality is that as a people, as a culture today, we get an awful lot more of this than we do of this. And we talked that week about the development of the synagogue model, that the Jews realized as they were headed back to Jerusalem, as they were going back home, that if they did not want to be so distracted by the idols of the nations around them, that they would have to find a way to make sure that they were giving more attention to God than just once or four times a year is what they were doing. Once a quarter, they were going to church. So they developed this model of the synagogue where they would come together and they would talk about God, they would read the Scriptures, they would learn the Scriptures, and they would do that every week. And that's kind of what our church today is modeled after. And then we talked last week about how the God space is a place to encounter the presence of God. We talked about how the presence of God had left the temple and had left Jerusalem, but then it came back. But yet we talked about the reality that in that vision, God's glory came back to that temple. But in reality, God's glory never came back and settled on a building again. But after that time, God's glory instead settled on people. And the New Testament model says that there is no temple that we're to go to, but that we are the temple of God in this world. That we are reflecting to the world around us what it means to be the presence of God in this world. And today we're going to wrap this thought up with three lines of thought, and hopefully we'll bring them together. First of all, making room for the God space. Second, the healing river. And third, the division of the land. If you have your Bibles, we're going to read, kind of jump around the book of Ezekiel. We're going to start in chapter 45 and then jump to 47 and then jump to 48. When you divide the land among the tribes of Israel, you must set aside a section for the Lord as His holy portion. This piece of land will be 8.5 miles long and 6 2/3 miles wide, and the entire area will be holy. And I just want you to understand, when I read these measurements, God did not use the American system. So the New Living Translation has translated those cubits, because anybody know what a cubit is? Our tape measures don't show cubits. So the New Living Translation has translated that into measurements that we would understand, which typically is miles. Now the problem is that they're not even numbers, and in the cubits they were even numbers, but here it's 8 1/3 and 6 2/3, so just ignore that part as we're going. But the point is that God said that there's to be a place that's His. A section of this land measuring 875 feet by 875 feet will be set aside for the temple. An additional strip of land 87.5 feet wide is to be left empty all around it. Within the larger sacred area, measure out a portion of land 8.5 miles long and 3 1/3 miles wide, and within it, the sanctuary of the most holy place will be located. This area will be holy, set aside for the priests who minister to the Lord in the sanctuary, and they will use it for their homes, and my temple will be located within it. The strip of sacred land next to it, also 8 1/3 miles long and 3 1/3 miles wide, will be a living area for the Levites who work at the temple. It will be their possession and a place for their towns. Adjacent to the larger sacred area will be a section of land 8 1/3 miles long and 1 2/3 miles wide. This will be set aside for a city where anyone in Israel can live. And then we jump ahead to chapter 47. And this vision, I read a little bit of this morning as we were preparing to worship, but I want to read this for us again. In my vision, the man brought me back to the entrance of the temple. There I saw a stream flowing east from beneath the door of the temple and passing to the right of the altar on its south side. The man brought me outside of the wall through the north gateway and led me around to the eastern entrance. There I could see the water flowing out through the south side of the east gateway. Measuring as he went, he took me along the stream for 1,750 feet and then led me across. The water was up to my ankles. He then measured off 1,750 feet, just in case you're wondering, that's 1,000 cubits. That's why 1,750. And led me across again. This time the water was up to my knees. Then another 1,750 feet, and I was up to my waist. And he measured out another 1,750 feet, and the river was too deep to walk across. It was deep enough to swim in, but too deep to walk through. And he asked me, "Have you been watching, son of man?" Then he led me back along the riverbank, and when I returned, I was surprised by the sight of many trees growing on both sides of the river. Then he said to me, "This river flows east through the desert into the valley of the Dead Sea. The waters of this stream will make the salty waters of the Dead Sea fresh and pure. There will be swarms of living things wherever the water of this river flows. Fish will abound in the Dead Sea, for its waters will become fresh. Life will flourish wherever these waters flow. Fishermen will stand along the shores of the Dead Sea all the way from En Gedi to En Eglaim. The shores will be covered with nets drying in the sun. Fish of every kind will fill the Dead Sea just as they fill the Mediterranean. But the marshes and swamps will not be purified. They will still be salty. Fruit trees of all kinds will grow along both sides of the river. The leaves of these trees will never turn brown and fall. There will always be fruit on their branches. There will be a new crop every month, for they are watered by the river flowing from the temple. The fruit will be for food and the leaves for healing. And then this is what the Sovereign Lord says. Divide the land in this way for the 12 tribes of Israel. The descendants of Joseph will be given 2 shares of land, otherwise each tribe will receive an equal share. I took a solemn oath and swore that I would give this land to your ancestors, and now it will come to you as your possession. Divide the land with these boundaries among the tribes of Israel. Distribute the land as an allotment for yourselves and for the foreigners who have joined you and are raising their families among you. They will be treated like native-born Israelites to you and receive an allotment among the tribes. These foreigners are to be given land within the territory of the tribe with whom they now live. I, the Sovereign Lord, have spoken. And I think the last verse of the book of Ezekiel is powerful. It says, the distance around the entire city will be 6 miles, and from that day the name of the city will be The Lord is There. Now, I've covered a lot of stuff, a lot of details, and a lot of you are glazed over and looking at your phones. Make sure that you're getting the full hour here instead of... I want us to kind of look at some of the themes that we saw in our reading. First of all, making room for the God space. The placement of the temple was not a random thing. Now, those of you who have been around here a long time, how many of you were here when this building was built? A couple of you were. Not very many, but a couple. A number of years ago, my first summer here, we had Dr. Forrest Whitlatch, who's now passed on, but he was the district superintendent over the Church of the Nazarene in Iowa when this building was built. And the church had their eye on a piece of property, I think off of Northwest Boulevard, and that fell through, and so they found this property instead. And so the pastor at that time, Tom Bailey, brought Dr. Forrest Whitlatch out, and Dr. Forrest Whitlatch said, Tom, I don't know, but if you promise me that this road will eventually be paved, then I'll give my approval. And so this spot was chosen for our church building because that road was eventually going to be paved. It's happened. I don't know when it happened, but it eventually happened. But this was kind of a, let's choose a place in town, a place with enough land. And I think Tom Bailey liked hills. At least that's what Dolores always said. Tom Bailey always bought land with hills. The parsonage at the time had hills, or was on a hill. This was in a hill. This church location was, I'm sure they prayed over it, but it was kind of random. It was just, where can we find the land? But in the place of the temple, in the case of the temple, it wasn't random at all. The placement was, this is where God says, I want you to measure out a piece of land this big by this big, and it was in a central location so that it could be accessible by all the Jews. It was had had a special place for the priests, a special place for the Levites, and a special place for anyone who wanted to live by the temple. And there was a place for the prince. And this is not the Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. This is referring to the kings of Israel. And prior to this resettling of Jerusalem, the kings had been kind of overstepping their boundaries as to what was their property and what was the temple property. In fact, there was some frustration because the kings kept building tombs for themselves closer and closer to the temple. And if you caught it, you probably didn't, but I did only because I knew this. God actually said, don't build anything in a strip around the temple. Don't put anything there. And he addressed this earlier when he said, I'm sick of you burying your dead kings here and then worshiping them instead of worshiping me when you come to the temple. So there was a place for the prince. There was a place for the king, a place for the government, but it was very clear that he was not to overstep his bounds. And then we read the section of this healing river. So there was a place for this temple. It was a very specific place that it was to be built. Because out of this place, a river was going to flow. And the river would flow out from the temple, gradually getting deeper as it left the temple, which typically that's how rivers operate, except in that territory, because in that area there is no water source that would flow together to make the river deeper. Talk about that maybe in a minute. And Ezekiel was paying attention to the depth and missed the bigger picture of what was taking place along the shores of that river. Trees were growing up along the river. But this was a desert area. When you guys went to Israel, did you go to the Dead Sea? I know you got to go to Masada, up overlooking the Dead Sea. The Dead Sea, I mean, does that lush, is that one of the words that comes to your mind when you're talking about the Dead Sea? Anything but. God told Ezekiel that the waters of this river would purify the waters of the Dead Sea. It would bring fish and wildlife to the Dead Sea. And that's kind of an interesting thought if you've seen the Dead Sea. I've not seen it. I've just seen it on the computer. But I wanted you to get a picture. I just have a 45-second video clip just to give you a picture of what the Dead Sea looks like. Lush, huh?
The Romans were well acquainted with the environment of the Dead Sea, an enclosed stretch of water lying at the lowest point on the planet. The area is arid and plant life practically non-existent. The name Dead Sea is well deserved. No fish can survive here, and the only life is on the scale of bacteria.
So this is the Dead Sea. And God told Ezekiel that this river was going to cause this sea to come to life. Now, what you're looking at here, and I cut this documentary off, it was a fascinating documentary, but this is actually the evaporating field. So they've set up parts of the Dead Sea where they can evaporate the water off and just get the salt. And the Dead Sea doesn't have sand for its beaches. It has salt. And there's these things where if you rub yourself with the mud from the Dead Sea, it's full of minerals and it brings you to life. At least that's what they say, because all the videos show people just covering themselves in mud. I don't know. If you did, at least you were smart enough to put pictures of it up there, you know. The salt or the minerals from the Dead Sea apparently are worth something, and so that's why they have these evaporated fields. Did you see any fruit trees growing up along the Dead Sea? They're on the other side of Jerusalem. But God told Ezekiel that there are going to be fruit trees growing along the river. Now, does anybody here have an orchard or grow up around an orchard? Okay, a couple of you have been around an orchard. Here's the thing. God said that this orchard would have a new crop every month. Now, the orchards I grew up around had one crop a year. God said it would be once a month. In other words, they're going to bear a lot of fruit. And not only were they going to be bearing fruit all the time, but their leaves would have healing power as well. And then he went on again to the division of the land. Land was designated for every tribe of Israel. The Levites would receive their area around the temple. And then there were 12 portions of land that would be given out to the different tribes of Israel. All the others would have a designated area. Special provision was made for the non-Jew. This doesn't happen very often in Scripture. Typically in Scripture, there's the Jewish and the Gentile. And they don't even talk nicely about those other people. But it was for those who were not Jews but had made the decision to follow God. So here's the question. So what? What does all this mean, or how does it apply to us today? And I'll be honest with you, I was in Des Moines most of this week and didn't get as much study time as I wanted. And a good part of my study time was spent just wrestling with God and saying, God, I don't want to misrepresent anything that this scripture is saying. I don't want to make it say something that it doesn't. So I want you to understand that these are my ideas. This is kind of the sense that I get in reading this. But I'm not saying that this is the word of God. I'm not saying that this is my prophetic voice. The truth is that the commentaries I looked at just skimmed over these sections because I think they were ready to get to the end of Ezekiel 2. But here are some thoughts that I've had as I've looked through this section of Ezekiel. First of all, I think that for the church today, that we need to be reminded to make room for the God space. As we've talked, we live in a culture that is inundating us with information. And in our lives of being inundated with information, where everywhere you go, there are screens. Even in the bathroom, we've got a portable one. I think they say that most people use their phone in the bathroom more than any other place. That accounts for the need to replace a number of phones a year. Making room for the God space in a world that surrounds itself with screens, in a world where we are constantly being barraged by information, we need to make sure that we're taking time and leaving room in our lives for the God space. For the last 2 weeks, I've kind of made it my practice to make sure I have some quiet time during the day. So when I'm in the car, instead of just plugging the phone in, I just turn the radio off. And I have some of that quiet time where I'm not being inundated. And sometimes when I'm in my office, instead of sitting in front of the computer, I just go sit on the couch. So I'm not looking at that screen all the time. Or when I'm at home, instead of kind of vegging in the basement in front of the screens, I just go up and I sit at the table with my family. Trying to make just space in my life, but also making sure that I take time for the God space. We don't do a very good job of that in our culture. And I could say, oh, but I'm listening to Christian music, or I'm listening to Christian podcasts. But you know what? If I'm taking all of my time and consuming all of this, I don't have any energy to hear what God actually has to say, because I'm just seeing what the screens tell me. And even though I know that Abraham Lincoln said you can believe everything that's on the internet, I don't know that he was right when he said that. And what does the Healing River teach us about the church? What does it mean for our church to be the headwaters of a healing river? Meaning that what takes place in this sacred space, when we worship, when we hear the Word of God, when we pray together, that what takes place here would bring life out there. Because it's easy for us in today's culture to just say, well, I go to church and I turn off the screens for a little bit, even though pastor's got three of them. What if what took place in this building or wherever it is that we get together, whether it's at a restaurant or whether it's at someone's home, that whatever takes place when we get together would be a stream of life for others that we come in contact with? And what if we recognized that we live where we live for a reason? Maybe it's so that stream of life can come into our neighborhoods. I firmly believe the church should be a place of priority, more so than it is in our world. And not just because we're supporting an institution, and not just because I think you should come and hear me speak, or that you should come and hear our music. That's not why I'm saying this. I'm saying it because this is how we're to remember who God is. When we come together, we're reminded of who God is. Instead of just being overwhelmed with everything that's going on in our lives. It's a chance for us to come together and to study God's Word together, to worship Him, and to be reminded of His presence in our lives. I think church should be more of a priority than 12 hours a year. I think we need more of God than that. I also think that the church should be a place that impacts our world in a positive way. A place where the river of God flows from. And it goes from here into the dry world. I think that the church is supposed to be a place where what we gain when we come together causes us to act more like Jesus Christ and causes us to love others rather than being a place that we come out grumpy and angry. Maybe this needs to be a place that gives us life that we take and share with those around us. Maybe the life that we get from coming to this place should influence what we write on that tip line at lunch. Maybe the life that we get in this place should impact the way that we treat that gas station attendant. Maybe the life that we receive in this place should impact the way that we treat the other people that live in our home. Because it's giving us life, and we share that life with others. And it brings life to dead things. Situations where it feels hopeless, but yet God works through what we can do when we're together and brings life to dead things. And maybe we are in our neighborhoods for a reason. Maybe because our neighborhoods need to experience the love of God as we let the healing river flow through us. Now, I know that we come from an awful lot of different neighborhoods. We have a couple of people from out of town that may not be included in this map. But this week, I was at a training. It was a church planting training that I had to go to. And one of the things that I did in this training was I just wanted to see, where do we all live and what does that look like on a map? So in case you're wondering, I don't know if you can see the yellow dots. This is a map of where we all live. And we're kind of spread out. I think, see, we've got some that live in Comanche and then DeWitt and then Rockridge and everywhere in between. Now, recognizing that some drive a little bit farther to get here, here's what a close-up of more the inside the 280 loop would look like. And we're kind of spread out. We have people in Rock Island and Moline and Bettendorf and Davenport and Bluegrass and Buffalo and LeClaire. What would it look like if every one of these dots on the map was a place where the hope of God was brought to life because of the time that we spend together? What would it look like if every one of us made it our intention that instead of spending 11 hours a day with this thing, Siri's artificial, she really doesn't care whether you're there or not. What if we spent a couple of hours a day praying for and thinking about and actually talking to those people that park in the garage next to ours? What if we actually got to know the people around us? You know, kind of like the old days before we had garages and air conditioning? Now, Bob remembers when the Dead Sea was just sick. But in those days before air conditioning and garages, when you would pull into your house and you wouldn't just drive into the house, you would actually, well, in Bob's case, you'd get off the horse and you'd take it out to the... The camel, yes. What if we ask God to help us to pay attention to the people around us? What if we ask God, God, what would it mean for us, since we do live in so many different places, and I'm not asking that we all sell our houses and move into one community so we can just be nice to each other, but I'm saying, what if we took the church home with us? That this river of God that flows in this story would flow and make a difference for each one of our neighbors. Now you may say, but Pastor, we live uphill from the church. And that's okay. Because in this story, there's no direct route. Even though the Dead Sea is in a valley and Jerusalem is on a mountain, there's another mountain range in between the Dead Sea and Jerusalem. So we can say that God can make that work and we'll just trust that He'll do that. But what if? What could it look like if God made a difference? That we were a faithful presence, that we represented Him to live this concept of the church across the Quad Cities area. What could that look like? What would it look like for Ezekiel's prophecy to be fulfilled in the Quad Cities? That the river of life flowed and brought purity to the muddy Mississippi. What would it look like for this to be the God space? That the healing river would flow from here so that our neighborhoods can experience His life. Now, what does that look like? I don't know. I'm reading a book called The New Parish, and I loved a quote from this book. It said, Jesus said that we are to abide in Him, and without abiding in Him, we will not bear fruit. The desire to bear much fruit is very good, but it cannot be turned into a universal strategy. No expert, in other words, pastor, can't tell you how to best love your neighbor. The best that an expert can do is share stories of how they've loved their neighbors or share best practices gleaned from the study of loving neighbors. Only the Spirit can guide you into the faithful presence, which is the love of Christ. But this is what God does. If we are open to His working in our lives, and if we say, God, I'm going to turn this thing off, and I just want to spend some time with You. Will You help me to know how to love my neighbors? Maybe it's as simple as getting to know their names. I'm ashamed to admit that before we got a dog and I went outside a lot every day, I didn't know my neighbors. I still don't know all their names. But at least I'm on a waving basis now. I know some of their names now. What if we got to know our neighbors better than we got to know Siri or Alexa? What if we got to know our neighbors and shared the love of Christ with them? I'm not saying preach to them. I'm saying love them. What would that look like? Friday night, I've been watching on Facebook a lot of the stories of the flooding in Nebraska. It's been kind of personal because I lived in Nebraska for 4 years, even though I lived opposite corner of the state from where the flooding is taking place. But Friday night, I had one of those dreams that you just wake up unsettled from. And it was one of those dreams that lasted all night. But in the dream that I had, and please understand, I'm not saying that this is God's message for us. It could very well have been the bad pizza. So understand how I'm explaining this dream. But in this dream, I dreamed that our church was located on one of the dams that was in danger. There's the Spencer Dam and the, I think it's the Quinn Dam in South Dakota that's still in danger. But I walked out alongside of the church and I could feel that we're in trouble. I could feel the ground giving way. And I'd go back into my office and I'd sit and I had the security cameras on. And I could see every once in a while one of the city buses, it was one of the River Bend buses, that would crash into the water. And so I would run outside and try to save as many people as I could as they're floundering in the water. And I can remember after my second time out there, as I walked back into the church, just saying, God, we can't do this on our own. As I watched that third bus crash into the river, and I can still see my feet vividly in this dream as I'm walking out praying, God, I don't know what we're doing, but please help us. Please help us to rescue as many of these people as we can as they're scrambling, trying to get out of this bus. And I think that maybe if we weren't so attuned to this, we'd be more attuned to see that our neighbors are going through tough times, that they are facing challenges, that they are desperately needing the hope that comes from Jesus Christ. They're desperately needing the hope of human relationships. Not saying we've got friends all over the world on Facebook, even though many of us do. That's not real relationships. Sometimes we need a human being to sit across the table from. I'm not an expert that can tell you, here's what it means to go love your neighbors. But I'm someone who's praying just like I want you to do, God, show me how to love my neighbors. God, help us to be a church where your Spirit flows and that what takes place on this hill makes a difference in the way that we live and the way that we treat others. May they find hope from what takes place in this place. As our worship team comes, we're going to sing our closing song together. It's my favorite closing song, I Refuse. And the reason I like this song is because it was actually written in a time of flood in Tennessee as Josh Wilson was driving around Nashville after floods had destroyed much of the town, and he said, God, please send people to help them. And he said he just felt like God spoke and said, I did, get out of the car. And so for us this morning as we leave this place, my prayer is that we will say, God, what do you want me to do? How do you want me to love my neighbor? How do you want me to be that stream of living waters that flows into the dry and the arid places? Let's stand together as we close.
Thank you.
Father, may it be said of us that we were a church that loved our neighbors. May it be said of us that we might be in our specific neighborhoods for a specific reason, so that we can show your love and your presence to those around us who are hurting. May it be said of us that we reflected you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And you are dismissed.